Gonna start already. First of all, I want to thank everybody for being and taking time of your spending time with families or working at hospitals or your centers. And first, we want to wish everybody is healthy, safe, taking care of themselves. But I want to thank that with all this webinar, you're taking your time to be here. And this is one of the topics that I get a lot of questions for all the different information we get from different societies all the time. So this topic for us is very important to follow. And we're going to discuss it a little bit now. First one, this is my disclosure. I have relations with a lot of companies. And then I want to discuss what you all know, like the Dunning-Kruger rule. If you see this curve, you will see that you have experience in the bottom, then you have confidence. So you have zero confidence here, 100% confidence here, non-expertise here, expert here. And that's what everybody go to some of this curve on where you are. But the rule is that when you are here, when you are close to 100% of confidence and you are very close to no experience, people start to say what they think, what their opinion, and not is based in many, many science. And as you notice, this has been happening a lot with the coronavirus. Don't do laparoscopy, do open. Open now, stay at home. This is not contagious. Whatever you've been hearing from a lot of people. So I have another disclosure. My other disclosure is this one. I don't know enough about this virus. Nobody really know a lot about this topic. I'm not talking about the virus. People know a lot about the virus, but not specifically what is the best way to do this or that, how to prevent this, when the vaccine is coming, where it's not coming. So there are many, many unknown things, and that's what makes it that confusing for everybody. Data has been collected, so we're going to know much, much more about this in a while. And as you all know, the world is full of experts in this virus. What I'm trying to do different myself, at least, is that the first rule of this club is that you don't know you are in the club. So for me, what I've been trying to do since the beginning is understand that I'm not in the club. So I'm trying to understand my ignorance. I'm trying to go by what I know and what I read. But also, I think one of the parts that we physicians fail a lot is we only pay attention to our science side. And as I was mentioned yesterday in another seminar, is that it's very easy to tell everybody stay at home and then you don't have contact with anybody. But that doesn't cover the social aspects, the economical aspects. So I read an interesting statistic 2 days ago. In this time that we have like 90,000 deaths in the US from the virus, we have close to 75,000 deaths related to alcoholism, drugs abuse, over abuse, and suicide. So add to that the economical aspect that now in this time in the US we have 39 million people unemployed. We move from 2 million to 39 million people unemployed in 2 months. So we need to consider that also when we suggest something to the patients or in our societies. So for me, one aspect is this ethical aspect, and I'm gonna just mention two here, is that yes, we all did this Hippocratic oath. We all say serve, protect, blah, 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 blah. And this has been working well for us, and it's been a rule that it was very good for all of us. And then when this started, and then Italy have more than 200 people from health workers dying because even the protection was not good, or because they didn't have enough, or we didn't know enough, And then everybody clap, then the superheroes, and then they plan to send the interns graduate early, the students graduate early, so they can send the young to the front line, because then the young don't die. That, I mean, what is that? I think one of the first job to every physician is different, and this is gonna change for a while. I don't think we're gonna see a new way of living, but I think we're gonna change some things like this. This is what we use before in the aspect to consider when we go to doctor. First one, we need to protect the patient. Somebody has a microphone open. Can you close it, please? Protect the patient, safety. Second, the cost, because that's the other burden they bring in to us in the last 4 or 5 years, is now we need to pay attention to cost. We, the surgeons, the physicians that were never teach anything about cost, now we are the administrators that respond to cost. They give you that money and then you see what you can do with that. Then we have to be aware of the malpractice lawsuits. And finally, it was the safety of the people who work in the hospitals, in the health centers, so health workers. Then this changed. And this is what it changed. And I decided myself to put the safety of the health personnel first. Because we as health providers, we need to go back to our families. We need to pay attention to them. We cannot be only concerned of not having enough protection in a hospital, dying from the disease, but also bring it to our homes. And then everybody clap. And that happened in so many countries. They don't let you in some of the banks or supermarkets because you dress like a physician or a health provider. So they clap you because you are the one who go in the front line. Well, you don't imagine a soldier going to a war without machine guns, without all the things they need, but they want us to go with not all the protection. And what we're gonna discuss today is part of that protection. Second, malpractice. Malpractice is changing a lot. And we're gonna discuss that too. But let's go very quick. You know what is coronavirus called like that? It's from the Latin word corona, that means crown. Until end of last year, probably February of this year, only 6 viruses were known to infect humans. 4 of these ones, they only cause like cold symptoms, but the other 2 are the ones who caused these pandemics in the last 2 decades. So it's important to understand how they are, how we can prevent this to spread. Hopefully we'll have a vaccine in the future very soon, a good treatment. But let me tell you this, we have vaccine for influenza, but last year 61,000 people died in the US from influenza. So nothing is gonna protect us fully against everything. Hopefully this disease, if you get the antibodies, that will do. But in the other diseases, even when you get the antibodies, they go away in 3 months, in 2 years. So we don't know that for sure. So we don't know if you get it, you're already treated with that. So even that there are some cases, hospitals are plan of the openings of the coming back to life, as I call it. I mean, not living is like dying. So we need to pay attention to other stuff. And that's what I mentioned it here. The curve flattens, life goes on. But it means we need to be protective for surgeon, staff, patients, and this is important for the hospital. Because what's gonna happen to the hospital when the quarantine regulations subside? This is other number that hit me yesterday. More than 9,500 people died in the last month or 2 months because they decided not to go to the hospital for other diseases because they can't even go because the hospital was only accepting coronavirus, or because they were scared, so they didn't go for the chest pain, they didn't go for that ulcer in your leg, they didn't go for that fever that they have related to an infection somewhere else, and they died because they didn't have a treatment for that disease. So we need to make sure that patients that we create a perfect or as best as perfect environment for the patients to come back for normal diseases. In a seminar yesterday, Diego Camacho from Montefiore, one of the hospitals in New York who's been hit hard with COVID, and mentioned that the number of emergencies went down 83%. Why, people are not having emergencies anymore? No, people are scared to go to the hospital. So we need to do the steps necessary to do that better. So what is the technical aspect that we need to consider? When we start to discuss that, we always mention patients with the disease versus patients with not the disease. I will say that every time I do surgery now, and when we start to open and do this elective surgery, I assume everybody has the disease. So we're gonna treat them like they have the disease. Are we gonna test? Yes. But are the tests 100% proof? No. So we're gonna treat every patient like they have the disease. Second, at the beginning, everybody starts to open the patient, laparotomies is better because the fumes, because the aerosolized. Later we discover that is not completely true. Then the safety of health personnel, use of pictures everywhere of people dressed in just plastic bags and people inventing the most different stuff. That cannot happen to health personnel because we are in the front line, like maybe the police, like the firefighters, like the para, the people who go in the ambulances. So we need to be different. And also I want to make emphasis in this. We need to do a very different or modified consent form for the patient. And maybe in the future, that consent form will include, like you see when you rent an apartment or something, like a lot of letters that nobody reads, but it says that we are using the proper equipment that includes blah, 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 to protect the patients to get some of these virus diseases. But already, if you go to a medical office here in the US, or you go to our office, or you go to our OR, the questions in the consent form, not in the history, in the consent form, it says, the patient was asked about fever, respiratory symptoms, traveling, exposure to somebody with coronavirus. So that is included now in the consent form. And that makes a little bit different. Also in the consent form, I include some of the tests that the patient had before surgery. So now we do tests in the office. We do them again before surgery, and we do them when they leave the hospital. And the reason for that one is more related to liability than nothing else. If you turn the TV, I don't sleep well, but if you turn the TV at 3 a.m. here, 2 a.m. in the morning in the U.S., you see already, like you see with the cars, ladies and gentlemen, if you acquire coronavirus, call us. We are here to protect you. We're going to get some money. You don't have to pay us if we don't make the money. So the malpractice has changed, need to change. It's going to be the usual one. And now you need to protect, or we need to protect, and the hospital need to protect themselves if the patient have the disease before or after. If the patient leave the hospital without the disease. Because how do we know that the patient is not going after the hospital to meet with someone who has the disease? What is happening now in the Congress in the US, I think is important. And that is good for liability, not only for physicians and hospitals. If the patient get coronavirus after laparoscopy, they can blame the company who produced the tower. They can blame the company who does the filters. They can blame anybody. So there is a law in Congress now. They try to make one of these new packages for stimulus. And the Senate is fighting that they won't be liability for businesses, hospitals, or physicians that open their normal work for patients in case they get the coronavirus during or after. That day will be, and probably that's gonna be approved in the next weeks, and that will give us some room. Even we're gonna keep testing, but that will give us some room on what to do with this patient. So what is in surgical smoke? And that's where we focus more on in what we're supposed to discuss today. But I think some of the other stuff is important to understand. As you can see here, yes, a lot of the particles go either through the nose, with surgical smoke, a lot of them. And that's what is important. There is more surgical smoke when we do open surgery, and it's go to all over the OR. So the indication to just go to open surgery is not necessarily the best one. It doesn't mean we cannot do open surgery. No, we can do it. But then saying you cannot do laparoscopy because it's worse is not totally true. It's a control environment. Maybe it's much easier to control that fume and that energy devices inside the cavity, like the thorax, like the abdomen, etc. But you see, you can have where they can deposit, what chemicals you can get, because it's not only biologicals, chemicals too. You can have nitrates, you can have carcinogens, mutagens, but from biology, that is what we have. And this in this column, you see what you can get from those deposits, asthma, pneumonia, even when you had malignant cells, live bacteria and viruses, and we expose to this every day. That's why you see changes in temperature in our ORs, and that's why you see we protect ourselves and we protect everybody who is in the room. We didn't pay that much attention to most of them because they were not causing a lot of trouble, but we were paying attention to those ones. So why? Because some things has been identified in surgical smoke. HPV has been identified in surgical smoke. HIV proviral DNA, HBV. What we don't have clear is what is the infectious potential, if there is a percentage, if there is a time of exposure, if there is just with the first exposure. We don't know that, and this is published for a while ago. This is published at least a year ago. And then this other paper that is very interesting, it was published in Occupational Environmental Medicine in 2016. They did this. They were trying to detect hepatitis B virus in surgical smoke during laparoscopy. And they took 11 patients between October 2014 and February 2015 at the Korea University Hospital. A very good high-efficiency collector they used to obtain all the smoke in the form of hydrosol, and that it was analyzed using PCR. All of the 11 patients had positive hepatitis B SAG with the antigen. Two patients have detectable HBsAb, and two were positive for hepatitis B and A antigen. Three patients without even taking viral medication at the time of the study. HBV was detected in surgical smoke in 10 of the 11 cases. Are we concerned about it? No, we're more concerned about puncture and ourselves and other stuff. But you need to understand that, yes, the virus can be there, the bacteria are there, so we need to be aware of that. So what are the air leak risk in surgery? When you do laparoscopy, we have the patient insufflation, that we always take lightly from that point of view because we haven't done much. Then the specimen removal. When we remove the specimen, we all hear, and you've been there, the smell of the products, whatever, we've been there, the fumes you smell, burning. So when you remove the specimen, things happen. So that's, for me, one of the biggest risks. And then when you deflate the patient at the end, and you're gonna close the trochar holes, what happened? We intentionally let all the CO2 go out because that causes pain for the patient. When we didn't do it at the beginning, the patients have pain in the left shoulder for 24 hours, 48 hours until the CO2 self-absorb. So I say that we have risk since the beginning and after the operations. So both the patients, but I say the staff should be they should feel comfortable coming back to the OR. Emergencies are emergencies. But now we're talking about elective, and let me tell you, for the last 3 weeks ago, we wanted to start elective, we went to all the meetings, we're gonna do this, that, blah, blah, blah. We called 14 patients that we had ready to surgery. None at that time, 3 weeks ago, none accepted to have surgery for different reasons. One, they don't have the insurance because they lost their job, so they don't have insurance now. Second, the one who have the insurance, they are scared to come to the hospital, or they don't want to have surgery elective now because they rather take care of their families, kids, wife, and their uncertainty that they don't know what's going to happen. So they don't know if this is going to get worse and then the family needs them, or now they need to go to work and now they are in the middle of surgery. So there are a lot of concern there. This is important. All of the societies that are related to this, they bring in their own, either for bariatrics or for laparoscopy that we're going to discuss. And then there are the IFSO guidelines, the American College of Surgeon guidelines. And if you are a fellow of the college, you get today another recommendations because we are ready to open massively elective surgery. And this week we already have more than 6 or 7 patients that want their surgery for June now. So we need to prepare for them. And they always ask, what protection I'm going to have? What are you doing so I don't get infected? And now I ask them, I'm not only doing things for not you getting infected, but we are doing this and that so our personnel doesn't get infected in case you have the disease already. So the conversation around it are changing, but you need to have in place specific things that the patients want to know, and you need to be able to explain to them. So the guidelines from the fellow, the American College of Surgeons are very interesting to me. We bring these specific topics. Aerosolization and droplet transmission of the COVID-19 virus are important hazards for surgical personnel. Also, this same aerosolization and droplet transmission increases when you do endotracheal intubation, tracheostomy, GI endoscopy, and a lot very high when you do evacuation of the pneumoperitoneum and aspiration of body fluid during laparoscopic procedures. So that means you have to be protected most of the time. SAGES, that base everything in endoscopy and laparoscopy, they send us this practical measure for laparoscopy, but if you read them, some of these are much easier to say than to do. Incision for pores should be as small as possible. And now you have this balance, okay? I'm gonna do my incision as slow as possible. But then I was teaching all my fellows until recently that my first incision, I like a little bit wider, so I don't have any pressure in the skin that make me push harder when I'm not seeing what is inside the abdomen because I don't want to perforate a vessel or anything else. So we need to even modify that. We're now putting the head of the trocar in the skin of the patient and we mark it. So now we know exactly the size of the trocar to go in there. Second, the pressure should be kept to minimum. And that's very clear to me. But also there is a minimum that is safe. There is a minimum that is not safe. Yes, we are not going to go to 18, 16. We can move to 13, 12 in some patients. But you need to see. If no, you are creating, you're changing one risk of contagion for another risk of creating injuries or doing injuries to your patients. But an ultrafiltration, either a smoke evacuation system filtration, I think it's going to be now standard of care. I think no one will do surgery without having one of these devices because that's the one who is protecting the personnel. And that's the only one who brings all these fumes, all this aerosolation and droplet to a container when it is going to be disposed properly like you do. Like we take care of something else like blood, etc. We're going to do that. Also, when you evacuate the pneumoperitoneum, it's the same. You need to do it to a filtration system before you close, before you remove the trocars. You teach that you need to remove through the trocars. And that's the other stuff that we're going to discuss, what you do now with the trocar phones, because that's a different story. I brought this from the TV because that's the proposal from the U.S., from the White House. We are already in this phase one. And as you can see, restaurants, some sporting venues, gyms are getting a backdrop. Gyms are going to take a while. But I think in Florida, Monday, now we're going to open some cafes, restaurants, with proper distance because people need to leave. Staying at home 6 months, 1 year, 2 years, living without working, it's gonna cause a chaos, but we have to do it safely. Because not living is like dying. And people are deciding, you see them in the streets now. So elective surgeries can resume. Schools and bars must remain closed. And even the bars ones, people in some states are fighting it. Schools, there was a manifestation, a parade of moms saying, okay, now I can go back to work and who's gonna take care of my kids? So a lot of issues that nobody really understands. So let's move to what is related to this talk. Again, patients with the disease versus no disease. And again, everybody has a disease. Laparoscopy by laparotomy is key for me. And let's move what I consider how we can protect the operating room staff. Remember, this is more related to this. I'm not saying you don't need to use the specific mask, the helmets. We need to do all that. But this is the specific related to the aerosolization and droplets. So there are three things that have to be considered. The insufflators, what we call the smoke evacuators, and the filters. And I went back to the first one. This is maybe one of the best papers. It was published by the two surgeons, one from China, one from Italy, through the coordination of Abe Fingerhoof from France. And they published it that helped us a lot to understand that the first move to just do laparotomy was probably, I wouldn't say a mistake, but was a misconception. Because what they did in these papers, and believe it or not, now annals of surgery, you see what is happening quick. You see case reports. Diego Camacho told me he sent yesterday a paper to annals of surgery that I'm gonna comment later because it's related to this too. But this one showed that the patients that went to open surgery more die than the patient who went to laparoscopy. And it was not for gallbladders. They have a Whipple, pancreatectomy, gastric cancer, and through laparoscopy, no patient died. But through laparotomy, some died. And then they discovered that when you have also laparotomy, you need to protect and limit much more the personnel who is inside the OR. So for laparoscopy, that is our topic, they should be respiratory limitation for pneumo. So one of the reasons some of the patients cannot go with laparoscopy with this virus, if they have appendicitis or gallbladder, because this patient of coronavirus is suffering of emergency like anybody else. So if you take them to the OR, if they have a respiratory compromise, you cannot do laparoscopy to them. We do low pressure for sure. We pay attention to the incisions more than ever, to the trocars, seals, and to the leaks. Leaks here are a big risk for our personnel and ourselves. Then we should use filters and smoke evacuators. And this is something interesting that I've read from two other papers and suggestions. I don't know if it's gonna happen, but people are gonna start to recommend use disposable instruments and throw them after surgery. And it will be much easier to dispose of them in case they have the virus or they have something else. It will be very expensive. So I don't know if it is gonna be the thing, but this is the other concern. And that's what I was thinking about. Once you enter one instrument and you take it out, it's already contaminated to whatever is inside. So you give it to the nurse, you put it up there, the same thing can happen. So some people are suggesting now that maybe you will need to do some cleaning to every instrument that you take out while you're doing surgery. That is a thing. Maybe we're gonna need another nurse, another person, another technician just to help sterilize, I will call it sterilize, but it's cleaning that instrument every time we take it out before we put them back to the patient. That would be a crazy thing, but that's maybe until we understand better this disease. Sages recommended, again, as I mentioned before, and we try to put together everything. So this is the recommendation from the group of Anna for surgery. This was published before it went to print. This is what they learned in China and Italy. And we need to learn from that because a lot of medical and health personnel die in Italy. a big percentage of the people who died in Italy were physicians, nurses, technicians, and that's very sad. So not because they're better than other public, it's because we are there to take care of patients, but we need to take care of ourselves, and that's part of this. So the instrument should be kept clean of blood and other body fluids. So every time you take it up, it has to be clean, at least. But if you have the same nurse and you need to think about it, to clean it and then have it ready, the operation will last 3 times more. So I recommend it's better to have another person, if possible, to clean that instrument every time you take it up. Hemostasis and cleaning of the trochal site or incision must be, what can I say, more obsessive than ever. And if possible, try to do it without using energy outside in the wounds. Some sick people like me, I just open the skin with a knife and then I go with the cutting of the energy device. So now you just go with the knife. If you see any vessel, you tie it. If necessary, you burn them. But usually we try to even pay attention to that. This must be more than ever before, liberal use of suction devices to remove smoke and aerosol during operations. So if you need now 2 suctions, you use them. And you have one of your assistants or whatever, every time smoke is coming, you will be suctioning if you don't have everything you need. Also, now you need to avoid using 2-way pneumoperitoneum insufflators because that will circulate in the insufflator. And now you have the infection already in the same place that you're going to put it. What about aerosol dispersal? You, again, CO2 ventilation at lowest level. And this is another thing that causes a little bit of difficulty, especially if you do obesity or you do obese patient in a colectomy or something like that. You need to reduce the trendelenburg position time as much as possible. Not the position itself, but the time. So I like usually to put my patient in trendelenburg when I put my first trocar. Now I'm going to put it after I put my 5 trocar or my 4 trocars, because that will help a lot. Only evacuate surgical smoke by the tap on the ports, if it's attached to an evacuation filter. Don't let it go outside to the OR. And only evacuate the pneumo by direct suction using a vacuum suction unit if you have it. What about for the technique? A lot of the technique goes for the energy. So the power setting of cautery should be as low as possible. And again, we are now in that safe position that you want good hemostasis, but you need to put this as low as possible. Second, and this is the one that not concern me, but I say this is very difficult. Avoid long dissecting times on the same spot with electrocautery, scalpels to reduce the surgical smoke. Then I was thinking, so usually my fellows use a different, take more time. So why? We're not going to teach anymore. I think it's better to do all the things we need to do to prevent that never go outside of that cavity that we have. We need to protect the staff. So I think we need to educate every person on the staff about myths and facts of the virus. Some people, I've seen it, not in our wards, but I've seen it in the hospital. Some people who bring patients sometimes, they have the mask and they touch the mask all the time outside. So using the mask, if you touch it all the time, doesn't mean anything. Or they use the gloves and they don't change the glove when we all know that the virus is going to stay in the gloves. So you go now to a supermarket and you see the ladies using the same glove the whole day. That doesn't help nada. It's better not to use the glove and then use a hand sanitizer if you do that. Also, make sure that you use the correct 2-way protective apparel, goggles, visor, mask, and body protective garb. Should be routine. And I think that's the other thing that maybe will become a routine. I cannot read the future, because now people are going to be scared of not this virus, going to be scared of other viruses that maybe are coming. If you have a patient that is very suspicious that have the disease or is already diagnosed, then we are adding a tertiary dress code that include that now the ventilation system in the OR is different, and there will be air purification equipment, and you make sure that only essential people will be in that OR. No visitors to observe that case, no people circulated that you don't need, so you need to limit that. So let's go to what we have. There is AirSeal, that's one of the devices that a lot of people knows. It's a popular smoke clearance infiltrator. He uses a closed loop system, but also uses filters and recirculates that air and sends it back. So he filters what he got and sends it back to the patient. Also, the good thing is a high-end insufflator with the custom trocars can be used. So this won't prevent the use of that one. What is good, what is not that good? What is good is a low pressure insufflation that goes with what we want. Second, it's a closed system. So all this is inside the system. It doesn't go to the OR, doesn't go to. And third one is surgeon proof. You know, surgeons, we are very idiotic with all these devices, so it's easy to use. What is a little bit of the contrast is it's expensive, it's not cheap. It's not very easy to transport to other rooms. So probably you're gonna need one in every room you're doing this. And that brings another cost in capital. And also still it relies on filters that have to be clean, so recirculating there. So there is good and there is bad. But what can you do to optimize your air seal now? Because this is the news before for the COVID-19. It has two modes. In air seal mode, then the trocar has a little bit of residual leak when there is excessive pressure. So if we are in 17, 18, then is how it's designed this device. If there is excessive pressure, the device will let some of leaking to compensate for that pressure. And that's not good for COVID-19. So you can help if you add a smoke evacuator in another trocar, so you minimize those pressure jumps. Because the smoke evacuator, what it does is he removes certain volume of smoke, and he controls that the same amount goes back to keep the pressure, and there won't be jumps. And that's what it does, this smoke evacuator, and that's what is pretty good. The other way to obtain a really closed system with the device is not utilize the air seal mode, but use the smoke clearance mode. When you use this smoke clearance mode, now you have a closed loop where one trocar is used to insufflate and a second trocar is taking the air out. So this helps to clear the smoke and all the contaminants, and they stay in the closed system. Then you need to use two trocars. Okay? In both situations, if you add the smoke evacuator, I will say it will be required, and I think it will become mandatory probably in the future, it's not now. But we don't do surgery if we don't have them. It's required to deflate the patient after surgery. That's the biggest risk when you deflate the patient after surgery. So if I'm gonna use the smoke evacuator at the end, I'd rather use it the whole operation, and I have the smoke clearance mode or the air seal mode with the smoke evacuator. What about filters? Filters that are different. Filters, they usually attach to an open trocar, okay? And they very passively filter the surgical smoke that it came out from the patient. What is good? They're very cheap. And cheap is good. They're very easy to install. That is pretty good again. Because now we have I heard a joke from one of the female surgeons here in the US. I said, it takes me now 40 minutes to dress up to protect myself in surgery and 15 minutes to remove the appendix. So imagine if we have now to add filters, smoke evacuators. So this has to be time consuming. So we need to account for that. So this is easy and cheap. What problem has? It's not very good for smoke clearance, actually. It's not that good. Also, the air that leaks goes directly into the OR. Also, the passive leaks doesn't mean any protection against the pressure, so the jumps can happen, and you cannot adjust it. So this is not the best thing for us for this specific situation. But you can optimize it too. You can optimize this filter. Why? It's to try to balance clearance with pneumopressures. So the filters come with a preset flow rate. It's not that you can change it, but the insufflator that you attach it must be able to keep up with that output. Usually it's not a problem, but there is no shout out. These filters might end up in a leak issue and you can have a problem there. What about the smoke evacuators? Smoke evacuators are smoke clearance devices. These attach to the trochers. And what they do is they vacuum from the source and suck all the smoke and contaminants out the operation space. So you don't see it in the OR. What is good and what is bad? What is good is that suction smoke and contaminant out the operating space totally. Second, are very available and easy to deploy if you need them. It has an automatic smoke removal. So you don't need to remove the smoke. It's going to come through that one. And also, because the regulation I mentioned at the beginning, they will prevent this jumping in the pneumo, because they're going to put the same amount from the insufflator that from the fumes that I removed. Sorry. The problem, you cannot use only that. It requires an insufflator and it requires a suction source. But it's not expensive, and you all the time has these two with you. What is the best way to optimize this VC-Max or smoke detector for COVID-19? Because it has the same clearance benefit as the other clearance systems, you can add and enhance their value if you use the adequate insufflator. It doesn't matter from which company. You need an insufflator that is good for the patient with high flow pressures and allowed to be attached to them. Second, because the device need to attach to two trochers, like I mentioned before, that you can do that with the air seal, that is better too. So now in my mind, we're thinking that most of the time, we're gonna end up two of the trocher to patients during the COVID times. So the device attached to two trochers and medical suction to do that smoke clearance mode on the air seal. So that's helped the air seal, and this helped us too. Also, you can put it in any device. It's not that I can use it only with Olympus, with Stryker, I can only use it with Storsno. You can use with any device, it adapts to any device, so you don't need a special connector. So you can use it that way. And lastly, it turns the smoke clearance in the highest setting when you deflate the patient. It's what it does. So while you're deflating the patient now, the amount of liters we have there already, it moved to its highest setting to remove the smoke. So when you deflate, it increases the settings to remove all that one. So I want you to understand, this is different companies, this is the products we feature here. And as you read down there, all products are trademarks or registered of the respective holders. Use of them does not imply any affiliations or endorse anybody. So this is some of the products we discussed to use here. If you go to Sage's list, and I recommend you do, you look for other products that Sage's recommend that you can use. I picked this one because they are simpler. I have practiced using them. I know them, but there are other ones. And there are other ones that I suggest you look at the list of Sage's, or you take a picture of this one, because maybe some of them you already have them in your hospital or you have it available. But if not, I will go also for the cheap and most effective. And probably the present and the future may be different, but the present, we put together good insufflator with the smoke evacuator, and sometimes it's needed the air seal. I wanted to add this here. We have been talking all the time about The highest risk is when you deflate the patient, but it's becoming almost a standard of care for the incidence of hernias after not closing the trocar hole, that everybody close the trocar. One of the bigger risk time that we saw in our patients is that when you want now to close the trocar hole, what do? Some people change that trocar for some little cones that you can put the needles there. When you change that trocar for that cone, you're already getting a lot of air outside of the patient. Second, you can use the needles guessing time, but you ended up moving, increase the incision. So I think in that risky time, I found that the new trocars will come like this one. This we try it is already available. And what it does is when you put the trocar since the beginning, it launched already in the trocar hole this, the suture, with a absorbable anchor that lasts 6 months inside the patient. So when you finish surgery, you deflate totally the patient. You don't need to see because the sutures, you saw them when you start surgery. You see how you place them. So when you finish surgery, you deflate the whole patient. Now you remove the trocars and you already have the sutures with you. And you just need to make the knot. So I think in the future, most of the trocar will have their own closing devices, that their own sutures that you can put since the beginning. And because they are absorbable, you are not concerned, and you saw how they look since the beginning. So you don't need now to go back, put the camera, look again. I put my sutures where? Did I go through all the layers? Am I going to close this? You have it already, and you don't need a CO2 inside the abdomen. Why is this important? This is a recent paper also from Annals of Surgery, and this is something that we didn't know. These people present that the virus is present in peritoneal fluid in the patient who already have the disease. And that is interesting to us because now you need to also make sure that there is not fluid, that the fluid is gonna go away as now the fumes go, because we don't know what is gonna happen when it's contaminated with that. I was talking with Diego Camacho 2 days ago because they have, I mean, I don't know how many patients they had in their hospital. Sometimes in their hospital, they have more than 120 patients, more than 70 in the ICU. So it was crazy in some places in New York. So he started to look for the virus in fluids, in pathology. And he's noticing now, and I asked him permission to mention this because he sent it to publication yesterday. He notices that if the patient has no symptoms, even if it's positive for the virus, there is no virus in the fluid or in the fumes. But if the patient is symptomatic, as other papers presented like this one, the virus is there. So that will be an interesting study that he already started with some of us. Is we're going to look in patients with symptoms and without symptoms. If there is really maybe patients that even have the disease with no symptoms, they are just positive and they're asymptomatic, maybe the virus is not that contagious. That would be something interesting to find out, and that's where we start to look for that too. So for me, in conclusion, the biggest problem we have is that we don't know enough and we are uncertain of what is coming. We know a little, so we need to protect a lot when we know so little. Maybe everything I'm saying today is bullshit in a month because they found something that you are isolated, they all are, and nothing happened. I don't have a clue. But when you don't know enough and there is a lot more to know, there will be uncertainty ahead. And we need to prepare for that. Or what are we going to do? We're going to stay at home 3 years and we're going to cancel all elective surgery or emergency? We cannot do that. We need to keep living, but we need to do it safely. And some people call this is a pandemic. I think we have two diseases. One is the pandemic. The other one is the panic endemic, because the panic that this creates has been causing probably much more death than the virus. People are scared to go to the wards. People are scared to go to the hospitals. People are not vaccinating their children because they don't want them exposed to the hospital. So now our children are going to die from measles, rubella. They're going to get polio because they are concerned of their virus. Yes, the virus is going to kill, I don't know, 200,000 people, 300,000 people. But we all know that the other things kill massively. So we need to do safety for all our patients. Thank you very much, guys. Do you have any questions? Any discussions? Let me see if I can put this here. And then.
Yeah, it's up to you.
Yes. So, I say good afternoon. Greetings. What about energy devices? I see a question. What about from Peru? What about the energy devices? And again, I think most of the energy devices are very similar. I will say that the energy devices, we need to use them, but we need to make sure that we use the one who produces less fumes, and we need to use them just not like we used to burn everything, but just very conscious, whatever we can tie or whatever we can. These clips, probably we ended up doing that more than burning them. Okay, did you hear me, Gerardo? I'm not sure you hear me, guys, but I probably was mute. Edmundo, for how long do you feel this is going to last as to keep the new recommendation you and others gave? I will say that as until we don't have a vaccine, until we don't have a good treatment, we need to keep this one. And I'm afraid some of this one, like the use of this smoke evacuator and filter, we stay forever. That is a good thing. I don't see it as a bad thing. But from the other part, I think vaccine, even that there are some, by the time they test, it will be 18 months. So we cannot wait for that vaccine. And we know that even with the vaccine, a lot of people die from diseases that you can vaccinate. And second, the treatment. And I think treatment was one of the other biggest misconceptions we had. When we sent everybody with medium symptoms, mild symptoms to their homes, those are the patients that if you treated early, probably with hydrochloroquine, with anticoagulants, with antibiotics, with anti-inflammatories, they never ended up in respirators. So we did the opposite. So I think we learned from that. So probably in the future, when you have your symptoms, you're going to go to a place that is safe, isolated. Patients who are very sick, they're going to go to a different place in ICUs. But we're going to allow people to come to they can get the treatment. And if you treat the mild ones, I think we're going to see much better things. Thanks a lot for the talk. Okay, then you say, Paul Santos, can you repeat the pros and cons of the insufflators? What I'm going to do is I'm gonna send to whoever wants some of this information, put the email here in the chat, and we're going to send all the information about everyone. So you will be able to have it, okay? What kind of emergency surgeries will you perform on 19-positive patients? Appendicitis, I will say, is the most common that we've seen, not in the volumes like some others have seen. But some of them went down there for many diseases, gynecological diseases. Some of the patients were pregnant, so they ended up going either for a C-section and removal of the fetus, or the normal life. But for us, appendicitis. Dr. Maftik Ahmed, the future of laparoscopy is in real risk. I think the future of human is in risk, but it's in risk every day. When more people die from car accidents, you see, I saw this other statistic. From January to end of March 2020, by the time there were, I think there were like, I don't know, 80,000 deaths in the whole world or something like that, maybe less. there were already 3 million people dead from cancer. There were like 1 million people dead from car accidents or from malnutrition. So I think laparoscopy is not in risk. I think laparoscopy today is safer than open surgery, because you can control the environment. You can control that cavity, the chest of the abdomen, so you can control how you can evacuate that and put it in a container, and that container will be disposed in a way that will kill all these viruses. Somebody's putting in emails, thank you very much. We're gonna send the talk to them so you get the information from the difference between all of them. Everybody, exactly, everybody's asking for information. Another question, approximately how much does the surgical team in the operation room is at risk to get that without some of this and other recommendations? Do many surgeons have gotten the virus? Oh yes, oh yes. A lot of surgeons, even here, a lot in Latin America from what I'm hearing, but the one who got more is the one who go to the front line, the emergency doctor, the ICU doctors, especially when we didn't understand well the protection, or when our health administrators, our health ministries, they don't give us all the protection material that we have. And people need to use the same mask for a month. And now they came guideline to re-sterilize your N95. I think there should be an N95 to change for every patient. They should be in. So we need better protection, and that they give us better sting to us. What else? Okay, I think that, what are the risks, Ahmed, what are the risks of healthcare professional infecting patients? It is there. So there are some hospitals that they are testing their own physicians regularly. I can tell you, my daughter works in Connecticut, and when one of her partners gets sick, she was sent home for 2 weeks, then they allow her to come back. Then suddenly 42 patients in a week got extubated. And now she needs to do neurological rehabilitation. Because what people don't mention much in all this forum, these patients are getting strokes. They're getting muscle wasting. These people getting a lot of the things that you don't see commonly in other patients. And now that she's seeing coronavirus patients every day, then she gets tested almost every 3 days. And they need to do every morning before, I don't know if it happened to you in your hospital. When I go to my office now in my hospital, there is a guy sitting outside, measure my temperature before I go in. They opened the party in my neighborhood yesterday or 2 days ago. When you go to the park, there is a guy sitting there, giving you hand sanitizer, giving you glove, giving you mask if you don't have, and they measure your temperature. So they are testing their own, because I think, of course, we can be transmitted to your family, to our own families, and to the patient for sure. Musa Kurshet, my friend from Kuwait, when do you think we resume elective? Do you believe in herd immunity as we should resume? I think we don't know enough about the immunity, but I think we should resume. I think it's not up to us, because I think we find a relatively very safe way to do this laparoscopy or surgery, even open surgery, but a lot of the patients are the ones who are stopping it. But the one who has an emergency, they come, but that's the problem. When they don't have an emergency that is not surgical, some of them are staying home and dying from MIs because they're scared to go to the hospital. So we need to make sure that we put all the safety measurements in place, but also that we let the public know that we're putting all this in place so they can come, and that we need to remove from them the lawyer side. Because if the physician's now gonna get sued because you did an appendectomy in a normal patient and he ended up with coronavirus, that you didn't even know if he got it 3 days before come to the hospital, when he left the hospital with the nurse, with a cousin, that will create a massive problem that nobody wants to see anybody. So I think some measurement has to come to some of these Should you recommend a new insurance for surgeons dealing with coronavirus? That's a good question. I learned from the insurance companies that they must be handled by lawyers too, because everything the lawyers do, they are protected and you are never fully protected. So I don't think there will be an insurance, but I think the malpractice insurance, if they don't create this law in liability that they are proposing in the Senate in the US, when you get the insurance that give you coverage for any of these infections, you will get that one. The big clinics will get that one, because it will be, I don't know if Masfika met asked me to, but I will read what he wrote here. I think I'm the only COVID positive doctor here. In the gathering, it's my 14 days of infection when I am safe to serve my patient again. I mean viral shredding. I think with the antibodies that you got, even that we don't know if they're gonna last forever, there are two papers, very serious papers, that said that if you get the disease once, you cannot get it twice. That if you are not, it seems like 2 weeks after. If you wait 2 weeks after your symptoms are gone or you recover, then you are not contagious anymore. So first, congratulations, Dr. Ahmed Julian. I hope I pronounced it well. Get out of this. Somebody call LK has the microphone open. You can close it, it will be great. What else? I think, where are the risk of healthcare professional infecting patients? I already answered that. I think I get it all. So I think I want to thank you again for coming at this time. It's very late for some of you. It's very early for another one. I hope this helped a little bit. The one who sent the email, we're gonna make sure you get all the cons and pros of all the products, because the list of products that you get in Sages is just a list of products. We're gonna get you some of this info. I make sure everybody get it here to give it to you. And thank you very much. Thank you much, Beringer, for helping us present this to everybody, because I think it's an important topic, more than when we can go, when the patients will come. I think we need to start to do some hands-on things. We need to go and do practical things, because we need to go back. The patients want to go back. The people want to go back. So are there measurements and precautions for restaurants and stores? They should be for us. So we'll add everybody to the list who send their emails. And thank you very much, guys, for being here. Thank you much, Beringer. Good night or good morning, and be safe and stay healthy. We are all in the same boat. Oh, I will tell you something that is very interesting to me. I'm gonna finish with that. I read this quote. Yes, when they say, yes, we are all in the same boat. No, that is not true. We are all in the same water. Some have yachts, some have boats, some have canoes, and some are swimming. So it's not everybody the same. Some people can stay home 2 years. Some people still receive salaries, like the political doesn't matter what they do. But most of the people need to go back to work, need to go back to new families. So we need to go back to life. Thank you very much, guys. Good night. Thank you, everybody.
All right. Thank you, Dr. Zundel. That was great.
Thank you, Alan.